Good evening and a big welcome to everyone, both in the room and online. We have a lot of attendance online too. I'm Professor Roberto Laragione. I'm head of the School of Biosciences here at the University of Surrey. And it's my great pleasure to welcome you all this evening. Today's lecture entitled The Future for Sleep, which will be delivered by our distinguished professor, Dijk. Sleep is a fascinating topic. We all need it. We all know how we feel if we are deprived of it, and yet we still don't fully understand why we sleep. However, we do know that getting enough sleep is essential to our overall health and our well-being. The advent of digital technologies and artificial intelligence and all the associated technologies now provide us with a multitude of technologies to monitor and improve sleep. At the University of Surrey, Professor Dijk and his team have made some truly groundbreaking discoveries that will help us all get a better night's or even day's sleep. His work particularly focuses on helping some of the more vulnerable in society, providing them with a better quality of life. And I look forward to hearing more about Dijk's research later this evening. This evening, we are celebrating not only the work of Dijk and his team that has been undertaken over the last few years, but also the 20th anniversary of the creation of the Surrey Sleep Research Centre that Professor Dijk founded in 2003. Professor Dijk obtained his undergraduate degrees, both a bachelor's and master's, and a PhD, a postgraduate degree from the University of Groningen in the Netherlands. He went on to conduct research at the University of Zurich, Harvard Medical School, and Brigham and Women's Hospital in the USA, before joining the University of Surrey in 1999. He has been researching different aspects of sleep at Surrey ever since, and as well as supporting undergraduate and postgraduate students, including PhDs. Dijk has won numerous awards, including a Royal Society Wolfson Research Merit Award in 2013, and a Distinguished Scientist Award from the Sleep Research Society in 2015. He is a Fellow of the Royal Society of Biology and the Academy of Medical Sciences. He's also responsible for bringing in approximately 17 million research funding, including a recent 1.7 million grant to further understand sleep and circadian rhythms in people living with dementia. Dijk has published over 200 peer-reviewed publications and many other articles and book chapters. Dijk's research focuses on the regulation and function of sleep and its interaction with circadian timing systems in humans. He examines how sleep regulation and circadian rhythms change across the lifespan and how sleep and circadian rhythms are affected by environmental factors, such as natural and artificial light. His research has resulted in a number of important discoveries, including demonstrating that sleep timing can be shifted by bright light, characterizing circadian process regulating human sleep, discovering the daily and seasonal variation in spectral composition of light, and discovering the association between circadian clock and sleep timing during week and weekend, as well as looking at sleep in older and younger people and different genders. And that's just to name a few. At Surrey, as I previously mentioned, Dijk established the Surrey Research Centre in 2003 and remains its director. The Surrey Sleep Research Centre is one of the world's leading centres of expertise in sleep and is home to a forward-thinking team of scientists, including physiologists, molecular biologists, neuroscientists, and many other scientists working very closely with clinicians. The scope of the centre's research is diverse, encompassing how digital technology and artificial intelligence can help monitor and detect changes in our sleep patterns and how sleep impacts brain function, including memory, and how insufficient sleep, which we may have, can impact people's physical and mental health. Under Dijk's direction, a real difference has been made to the lives of those who suffer from disrupted sleep. For example, practical recommendations aimed at helping people living with schizophrenia to manage sleep disturbances, which appear to be driven by inadequate light exposure patterns, and a project to better understand how sleep cycles are altered in dementia and how they affect the lives of people living with dementia and their caregivers. Also, as part of the University of Surrey's new Centre of Excellence on Ageing, the Surrey Sleep Research Centre will seek to determine the role of sleep plays in promoting a healthy ageing process. As the head of the School of Biosciences, I can't wait to see what the next 20 years and beyond holds for sleep research at Surrey. So it is with my greatest of pleasure that I hand over to Professor Dirk Jan Dijk. Dirk Jan.
Well, thank you, Rob, for that very generous introduction. Good evening, everybody. Yes, I'm going to talk about sleep and ask the question, is there a future for sleep? We had a little celebration a couple of weeks ago, and this was indeed around the 20th anniversary of the Surrey Sleep Research Centre. The instructions we gave for the speakers was that it shouldn't be about the past. It should indeed be about the future. And this is what really happened, and I will refer to that event now and then. That event was also sponsored by the Institute of Advanced Studies, and I'm grateful for that as well. So one question for the future obviously is, will supermarkets sell sleep? But we know it's difficult to predict the future. But the good answer to that question is yes, supermarkets are very much interested in sleep. What you're looking at are data collected by Sainsbury and Oxford Economics. And they were interested in the well-being of Britons. And you can find this information on the web. And they actually interviewed 8,250 participants, which is not too bad. And this was a representative sample of Great Britain. And they asked them all kinds of questions around their well-being. And then they divided that particular group in, you know, the people who lived very well, who had a very high level of well-being, and those who weren't that well off. So you had the bottom and top 20%. And then they looked at the factors that distinguished these two categories. And you can go from bottom to the top, and you see that overdue deaths are not a problem at all. It doesn't contribute to your well-being. Spending time outdoors becomes important. Mental health, obviously. I will skip sex life, satisfaction, and go immediately to support network, which is important. But then actually sleep quality comes out on top. And maybe that's surprising, or maybe that's not so surprising. The reason I like these data, you know, if you ask Pep Guardiola what's the most beautiful sports in the world, he will probably say football. If you ask a sleep researcher what's the most important behavior, he will probably say sleep, but of course we are a little bit biased. I think this is really unbiased evidence that sleep is very important. Now in the title, you say we value sleep more than anything else. Actually, it turns out that if you are an average person and you have an average disposable income and you would like to have your well-being as good as the top 20, sleep quality is as powerful as multiplying your disposable income by four. That's the value of sleep. Now, sleep is doing more. Sleep quality associates with mental and physical health. You can ask people to complete many, many questionnaires also about their sleep, but also about their physical and mental health. And if you then look at the strength of the association, you will find indeed that sleep quality associates very strongly with mental and physical health, actually more so than the duration of sleep or whether you are an early or late chronotype. So that's a direct association. But of course, since we are interested in the future, we would like to know whether sleep predicts. And actually, it does. This is an older study from a Norwegian research group, and they went through the trouble of interviewing 24,750 people in the working population. And then at the beginning, they ask, do you have insomnia complaints? Yes or no? 11 years later, they ask them questions about their mental health. Are you depressed? Yes or no? The odds ratio was 2.4, which basically means that indeed, when you had sleep problems 11 years ago, you were now much more likely to be depressed than those people who said they didn't have sleep problems. And that is a finding that you will find everywhere in the literature. So I hope I've convinced you that sleep is important. You may wonder, you know, what other questions are we going to answer? Well, these are some of the questions that I want to go through. Where do we do our research? How to measure sleep? What makes a good night's sleep? Ageism and sleep. Rob already mentioned the new center on aging and the excellent signs we're going to do that. How much sleep do we get? What happens if I don't get enough sleep? Do we need to police sleep? And some of you may be reading The Guardian and have read about this. What's the economic value of sleep? I already gave you an answer to some extent. I'm going to talk quite a bit about sleep and the future of the planet. And then finally, of course, I'd have to say something about the bedroom of the future. Okay, this is where we do our research, in the clinical research building. For those of you who are local, it's basically in between Tesco and the sports center. And you can see it's quite a nice building. If you go inside, you see that there are a lot of clinical rooms where we can do our research. There are clinical research nurses. We obviously can sleep people in that particular building. But that building is set up in such a way that we can do research in these people, not just for a night or for a day, but we can keep people there for a week or even a month. And that's quite unique in this country and also for other countries as well. We can draw blood samples, we can record brain waves, and in general, people are very happy in that building. More recently, actually during the lockdown, we built a UK Dementia Research Institute living lab facility, specifically to do research in people living with dementia. So one of the things we set up was a bedroom where we didn't have one bed, but a double bed, so that if a person living with dementia wants to participate in research, but doesn't want to be alone at night, their partner can also come. And as you can see, people are very happy. I should say that we are very grateful for participants in our study. They make time available to come to the lab, to do things at home, to answer questions, to give blood samples. And in general, people are not only just very generous with respect to their time, but they are also really interested in the research. And many of the participants, when we ask them, why do you participate in our research? They will say, well, we want to help and we want to know, and we want to know more about sleep. One of the things many people want to know is what sleep tells them about their health, their future health in particular. Good. You saw on the previous slide, the lady with an electrode cap on. And this is a way in which we can record brainwaves. We can record these brainwaves for an entire night from 11 o'clock to 7 o'clock in the morning. And we can then analyze those brainwaves. And what you can see is that there are cyclic changes in the course of a night. We can put them in wonderful colors, and we can ask somebody to score all of those 30-second epochs. We can be awake, we can be in non-REM states 1, 2, and 3, we can be in rapid eye movement sleep, and now and then there are awakenings as well. So if we want to know, you know, what is a good night's sleep, we may want to analyze these data and see which aspects of the physiology tells us how in the morning people will respond to the question, how good or how bad was your sleep? So we did this study quite a few years ago now in 206 people. We had a broad age range, 20 to 84, and this sample was extremely healthy. No high blood pressure, no diabetes, no whatsoever. Now you can record sleep not only by those brain waves, you can also put a simple video camera on the beds of people. And you can see a person on the left, you can see a person on the right. These are 8 hours of sleep in 1 minute of video. And you can clearly see that one person sleeps differently from the other person. Okay, is this important? Well, trying to answer the question, what's a good night's sleep? You do the following. As I mentioned, in the morning, you ask people, what was the quality of your sleep last night? Very bad or very good? Then you correlate this with all these sleep stages. You correct for age and sex differences. And now you can come up, you know, with a prediction of a particular sleep stage. Is it good for sleep, for your subjective sleep quality, or is it bad? You already see that these awakenings are bad. They give a negative contribution to the quality of sleep, and you may expect this. We see that rapid eye movement sleep, that's the sleep stage during which we dream the most and have very vivid dreams, has a positive contribution. So it is important. Interestingly, if we look at deep sleep, that actually doesn't contribute that much to sleep quality at all, even though we always read that deep sleep is so important, but it doesn't contribute to how we feel about our sleep. And we are not the only ones who actually have that particular finding. What about differences between men and women? What does it mean when your female bed partner in the morning says, oh, my sleep wasn't very good? What does it mean when your male bed partner says, oh, my sleep isn't very good? Well, if the woman says her sleep wasn't very good, then that does tell you something about what happened during the night. If the man tells you that his sleep wasn't very good, he just says something. How can you see this? You can see this in this graph. This is now the strength of the prediction in women versus men. And this is again REM sleep. And you can see that that strength of the association is much stronger in women than in men. Where that comes from and what it means, we don't know. But it shows that, yes, there are differences in sleep, not just the self-report of sleep, also the physiology of sleep is to some extent different between men and women. Rob already mentioned that there is a new global center of excellence on aging, and it launches with a clear call for action against ages. I'm becoming more and more interested in this center of excellence and also ageism, ageism and sleep. What is it? Of course, many societies getting older and older and older, and many governments want to make sure that older people that stay in work, are participating in society, and that they are not just written off because they are now 66. Of course, it's also true that there are certain ideas we have about aging and sleep. Maybe we feel that, oh, older people are sleepy people. They will nap a lot, and what can you say? So we decided to have a look at this. And what we did was asking, and that's actually within the sample of 206 I mentioned before, you know, how sleepy do people say they are? We use the scale, which is called the Karolinska Sleepiness Scale. It was invented, as the name suggests, at the Karolinska Institute in Sweden. It's a 9-point scale. 1, you are extremely alert. 5, neither alert nor sleepy. 8, sleepy, some effort to keep awake. 9, very sleepy, great effort to keep awake, fighting sleep. So you can ask people this question and do this in young and older people. And the answer is, well, lower score means less sleepy. It's the younger people who on this self-report are sleepier than the older people. Now, remember, these are very healthy people, okay? And many of our ideas about sleepiness in older people may be related to health conditions, which makes them sleep. But if you're old, and older, if you're old and healthy rather, you are very likely to be less sleepy than your children, or maybe even your grandchildren. When I presented these data for the first time, people will say, well, these older people, they don't know how sleepy they are. And that's actually quite a typical response. So you can now see, you know, what about objective measures of sleep? And what kind of objective measure can you take? Of course, one measure of sleepiness is, do you fall asleep very rapidly? How do you do this? We ask people 5 times per day to do a nap, to try and take a nap in the lab. The first one is at 9, we do one at 11, we do one at 1, we do one at 3, and we do one at 5. This is the napping during office hours protocol, which actually works very well and is widely used. So now, of course, this is a latency test. So less sleepy means higher values. And what we see is that also on this objective measure, older people are less sleepy than younger people. This is an interesting finding and maybe somewhat unexpected. And how do we explain it? Well, one way to explain it is to look at the following very simple cartoon. Here we have age. We go from young and older. We have something which we call sleep need in blue, which goes down with age. And we have something like how much time do we allocate to sleep? How much time do we spend in bed? And the idea is that the young people don't spend enough time in bed. And older people sometimes may actually spend too much time in bed. But if we accept that sleep need goes down with age, but we tell everybody you should sleep for 8 hours, then you can easily see why the younger people are sleepy and the older people are not so sleepy. So that's one thing. Okay, we've been talking a little bit about sleep and sleepiness, but how many hours of sleep do we actually get? Well, fortunately, there are now good organizations that do large surveys like YouGov. And these are recent data, approximately a year old, where they asked 2,512 adults in Great Britain, how many hours of sleep do you get? And what you can see is that 35% of the population reports sleeping 6 hours or less, 8 hours, 20%, and 7 hours, also 35%. And maybe that sounds reasonable, but the question, of course, is this enough or is this not enough? Now, before I'm going to talk to you about it, I want to talk a little bit about this slide. I'm not sure it's in the right place, but it's an important slide anyway. We talk about sleep, and yes, we think sleep is important, but do we actually translate it into economic value? Of course, there is health economics, people who start to calculate how much it costs when you don't go to work because you didn't sleep well. Or what does it actually cost when you are less productive because you have a sleep disorder, or you have to go to the GP, or you have to get sleeping pills? And when you do this kind of analysis, they come to the conclusion that the cost of insufficient sleep in the United Kingdom is 50 billion per year. And that at least is a reasonable number. You always have to tell people how much it costs before they will take you seriously. We hope that these numbers actually help. But yes, okay, so what happens? What happens if we don't get enough sleep? Now you may say that, oh, how do you study this? And there have been many studies where this question was answered by saying, okay, I'll just keep you up all night and then we'll see what happens. But that, of course, is not very realistic. What happens in real life is that you get 5 hours of sleep, 6 hours of sleep, maybe during weekdays, maybe you sleep in during weekends. So if you really want to find out what the effects of insufficient sleep are, you do a protocol like this one, which we did here in Surrey, in this building. So So we took 36 healthy participants, and they came to that building on two occasions. On the first occasion, you know, we made them get used to the environment and gave them 8 hours of sleep at night. And then for a week, they had to stay in bed for 10 hours, okay? And then at the end of that protocol, we took blood samples and we did a whole lot of other things. In the other condition, they were allowed to be in bed for only 6 hours. We recorded these brain waves every night and scored the sleep. And we found that in the 10 hour, in the sufficient sleep condition, people slept on average 8.5 hours, not too bad. In the 6 hour time in bed condition, they slept 5.7 hours, which isn't that severe a sleep deprivation. And many of us may actually experience it, but it is sleep deprivation. So at the end of the protocol, we collected blood samples and we want to see what kind of changes we could observe in blood. In particular, we were interested in gene products, RNAs, and see whether they changed. Is there an effect of insufficient sleep on the transcription of our genes? So we analyzed 22,862, and Simon Archer, who is here, was very much involved in this study. And indeed, we did find changes in gene expression. Actually, 444 were downregulated, and 267 were upregulated. You can now start looking at the kind of processes that are associated with those genes that change. And one of them is gene expression regulation. Another one is immune responses. And of course, now it is starting to become interesting because in a way you can start seeing how insufficient sleep could lead to certain health consequences, because insufficient sleep leads to changes in those biological processes that are actually important for our health, like immune function. So what kind of data do we have in the literature? This is an older study. It's not from Surrey. It was Cohen et al. Archives of Internal Medicine. They did something very simple. They took a bunch of people, 153 to be precise, and they were between 21 and 50 years old. They assessed how long they slept. Then they exposed them to the rhinovirus, common cold. They then were monitored for clinical cold. Did they develop symptoms? And then they investigated whether there was a difference between those people who slept less than 7 hours and people who slept more than 8 hours. And what you can see is that those that only slept or slept less than 7 hours were much more likely to indeed develop cold symptoms. And this, of course, one can easily see relates to changes in immune function. And we already saw in that experiment that we see changes in expression of genes associated with immune function. More recently, of course, there's an enormous interest in sleep and COVID. And there are many studies out there that describe how sleep changes during lockdown, how sleep changes during COVID. But the study you see here on this slide is a meta-analysis where people looked at all studies on sleep restriction, restriction and immune function. And they actually came to the very strong conclusion that indeed restricted sleep impairs immune function. And one of the sentences you can read on that slide is that, so the antibody response in response to vaccination is reduced. The reduction is similar to the waning of COVID-19 vaccine antibodies over 2 months. So that indeed is quite an effect. Of course, the question is, you know, why is there this relation between sleep and immune function, and what are the precise mechanisms? And I don't think that we really know the answer. Okay, so that was insufficient sleep a little bit of health and immune function. But what about sleep, insufficient sleep, and behavior? How does our behavior change? In that same experiment, where the participants came to the building on two occasions, we didn't only draw those blood samples at the end of the experiment, but we also made them do many different things throughout this entire week. We pay these participants and they better work for it. It's not that they didn't do anything. So we did simple tests like a reaction time test, where you simply have to respond as soon as there is some kind of a stimulus. We did more complicated tests like working memory. And the way this worked, these are so-called N-back tasks. We have the one back, the two back, and the three back. In the one back, there is a letter on the screen and you need to say whether it's identical to the previous one, one back. You understand that for the two back, you have to say whether the letter on the screen is similar to the letter two back. And for the three back, you have to say whether the letter on the screen is similar to the letter that was displayed three items back. You will probably agree with me that the one back is simpler than the two back, than the three back. Then we also ask people at the end of that particular test, you know, how much effort did you have to put in conducting this particular task? Of course, effort is very important. You know, how much effort do we have to put in completing our daily task? So these are the results. So what we're looking at here is an effect size. So that's the size of the effect of insufficient sleep. And here we have our Karolinska sleepiness scale, the 1 to 9 scale. Here we have reaction time. Here we have working memory. And you see that the largest effect is actually on sleepiness. The second largest effect is on reaction times, which we assessed with two tasks. And you see that working memory is actually not that much affected. Actually, the most difficult task, the three back, is the least affected. This may be an unexpected result. That result, however, you will find in almost every publication on this particular topic. It actually means that the largest effect of insufficient sleep is something that comes first, that is sleepiness. What happens if you don't eat? What's the first thing that happens? You become hungry. And the same thing, what happens if you don't get enough sleep? You become sleepy. The other thing that has a very large effect is the measure of effort. When you do have insufficient sleep, you don't get enough sleep, you have to put in more effort in completing these tasks. So for these complex tasks, where people still perform very well, we did see that that maintenance of performance came at the cost of more effort. Nevertheless, the thing is, sleepiness is something that happens if you don't get enough sleep. Why is that important? People will say, oh, sleepiness, does it kill? Well, sleepiness actually does kill. When we look at driving a car, at driving accidents, certainly single vehicle accidents, and we read the literature, we see that 10 to 20% of all crashes are estimated to be caused by driver fatigue. Most of them happen in the early morning. So overall driver fatigue, falling asleep at the wheel, is a major concern. Now driving, of course, is a relatively simple task, certainly at night when there is not much traffic. It's a bit like doing this rather boring reaction time task, where you saw quite an effect of insufficient sleep. So this receives a lot of attention, and rightly so. It's an important issue. And more recently, some of you may have seen, actually it was on the 8th of May, Linda Geddes, she's a journalist of The Guardian, and she actually attended that little celebration we had here in Surrey in April, published this article that indeed there is a blood test for sleepiness. And could you use the blood test for sleepiness to to use in accidents to find out whether the driver who may have caused the accident was very sleepy and hadn't slept the night before. And then she wrote, blood tests for dangerously tired drivers may enable prosecutions, which obviously is an interesting area indeed. Now, just to show you a few more data about these accidents and when they occur, these are data from Italy. Here we see time of day. Here we see the relative risk of falling asleep, or that sleepiness was involved. It is at night and less so during the day. Just to back up that previous data about young people being more sleepy than older people, if you look at the likelihood that the young people is involved in one of these sleepiness related crashes compared to older people, you see indeed that it's the young people who are most at risk. So if you go on your trip to France on the bus, you have to choose between a 50 or 60 year old driver or a 20 year old driver, pick the 60 year old driver. He will stay awake. The older driver will fall asleep. But back to that blood test for sleepiness. We actually developed such a blood test, at least in principle. So what did we do? You know, we had these participants. You already saw that we kept them in the lab for 2 baseline days and then 7 of these 10-hour or 6-hour time in bed days. After that, we kept them awake for an entire night. Then they go to sleep. But we did do a total sleep deprivation as well. We drew more blood samples and more blood samples. What you now can do is you can take blood in this particular case at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, before you sleep deprive them for an entire night, and the next day you take another blood sample. You analyze the data so we can look at all those gene products in blood. You use a little bit of machine learning, in this particular case, very simple machine learning, and you can see whether you can find a combination of those molecules that tells you whether the blood sample had been awake for the entire night or was drawn after a normal night's sleep. And you first develop the test on a training sample. You train the model, as it were, and then you test it on a validation sample. So basically, you now give blood samples to that algorithm, but the algorithm has never seen that blood sample before, has actually never seen the participant from which you took that blood sample before. And much to our surprise, I think there were something like 37 markers in that predictor. With 92% accuracy, the algorithm can say whether the sample was taken from a sleep-deprived participant or not. So yes, in principle, this is going to be possible, and in a way that is going to be very exciting. So that's some of the things we are doing. Now, after Linda Geddes had published her article about, you know, blood samples for sleepiness and prosecution, there was a deluge of comments in The Guardian about this. And it's very interesting to read these comments. That article was written by Barbara Spee. Our obsession with sleep is doing more harm than good and ignores the real problem. She felt that sleep should not be policed and that these blood samples and that biomarker were just a way to police sleep. I, of course, would say it's a good thing to police sleep. But it's very interesting to read some of these comments. You know, first of all, you know, what she said, or as is more likely, the culture of personal blame could balloon further. Driving for 14 hours a day, perhaps try a lavender sleep spray. 2 toddlers, have you considered a 1,000-pound mattress? And she bringing in some kind of socioeconomic, sociological argument. It's easy to talk about sleep, and it's easy to say you need to get enough sleep. But what if you have to do two jobs to bring enough food on the table? And it indeed is an interesting discussion. Of course, other people had a more cynical approach, or maybe a more optimistic approach. What's the problem? Won't we all be in driverless cars soon, and this entire problem goes away? Anyway, let's not go further into it, but it is a very interesting discussion about how seriously do we take sleep, and should we take it as seriously, sleepy driving, as drunk driving? Of course, there is no reason why we shouldn't take it as seriously. And that's, I think, part of the discussion. We are already legally obliged to be fit to drive. And if you are extremely sleep deprived, you are not fit to drive. Even though, and younger people probably in particular, feel that they can overcome their sleepiness and drive nevertheless. I should say that, and I'm not going to dwell on these slides, apart for a biomarker for sleepiness, we also developed a biomarker to find out what time of day it is in your clock, which may be useful if you are suffering from jet lag, which may be useful if you are a shift worker. And it's again a very simple principle. We know that there are many rhythms in our body, and these rhythms have all a slightly different timing. And if you take a blood sample and you ask a machine learning approach to tell you from that one blood sample what time of day it is, that blood sample can actually do this. So we have blood samples for sleepiness, we have blood samples for brain time as well. And this particular technological area is really the area of developing new markers, biomarkers, be it for sleepiness, be it for biological time of day. And there is an important future for these new biomarkers, because it will make it much more easier to assess whether somebody has insufficient sleep, or it will become much easier to assess whether there is a problem with the biological clock of a particular individual. So that's one new area. Briefly, sleep for the future. Long-term effects of insufficient sleep and dementia. As Rob mentioned, we are funded by the UK Dementia Research Institute, and there is an enormous interest in the associations between sleep and cognitive decline. This is a study, the very famous Whitehall 2 study, civil servants. 7,959 participants were asked about their sleep, and they were followed up. And the follow-up was, if I remember correctly, approximately 6 years. Persistent short sleep duration at age 50, 60, and 70 compared to normal sleep was a 30% increased risk of dementia. So that's a reasonable increased risk. And the question, of course, is, you know, how does this happen? What does sleep have to do with dementia? And this is what we're currently focusing on quite a bit. You know, we study sleep and circadian research to better understand how sleep disturbances contribute to the risk for dementia, and how enhancement of sleep or reducing these disturbances may slow down disease progression. Sleep disturbances are prevalent in dementia. They also contribute to caregiver burden, and often they lead ultimately to a loss of independent living. And people living with dementia want one thing, and that is live at home for as long as possible. So we are studying this, and I want to tell you a little bit about some of the things we are doing. So very briefly, we know that sleep and circadian disturbances have an interaction with dementia. Okay, sleep disturbances are a risk factor, a symptom, and a burden. The questions we're trying to answer is, you know, what's the extent and nature of these disturbances? What are the mechanisms, and can we come up with interventions? Now, importantly, if we want to investigate this, you know, we need technology that will allow us to monitor sleep, not just in the laboratory, but also at home, preferably for longer periods of time. And importantly, that assessment of sleep should not be a burden for the participants, because people just want to get on with their life. So we are looking into these technologies, and we do this in collaboration with Imperial College London, Care Research and Technology Centre, but this is our local DRI team. And these are people with many different skills. Some people are molecular biologists or sleep and circadian physiologists. There are people who are into experimental medicine or clinical trials. We have doctors. It's also quite an interesting, even though the team is local, the members are quite international. Ela has a PhD student. She's from Iran. Ciro della Monica, as the name suggests, is from Italy. Ines Wieland is from Portugal. Giuseppe, obviously, is also from Italy. Sara is from Malaysia. Ulrich Bartsch is from Deutschland, as you would expect. Talia Rodriguez comes from Mexico. And yes, we even have people who have links with Scotland or Wales. Isn't it amazing? But sleep research is a very international enterprise. And what we do is we test all these new technologies, things you can put on your head and it will record brain waves. We call them wearables. You can also put them on your wrist. Earables. These are obviously things you put in your ears and can record brain waves from your ears. And then there are nearables. Nearables are very interesting. You put a radar system next to your bed and it can actually record sleep. Basically what we do, we give people all these things, send them home, they record, they use the equipment, and then we bring them back to the clinical research building and compare the measurements with these novel technologies to the gold standards measurements. And this is, you know, one study we did, which was in older people, you know, with 35 participants. As you can see, the average age was 70.8 years, 65 to 83. We have some participants who couldn't participate and were complaining because they were 86. Said, you know, why is your cutoff 85? So I think we have now changed it. It's very interesting to see blood pressure, not too bad. Now, what we do discover that these people, whom we don't exclude if they have health problems, many of them have health problems. For example, sleep apnea. 40% of the people had mild sleep apnea and 26% moderate or even severe. So this is a realistic sample of older people, and we do this on purpose. We also had several health conditions like diabetes, and a medical history of, you know, hernia or cancer, etc. This is a complicated slide. It's very unfortunate that this little black box is there as well. But what it basically shows you is how well a very simple device, the Whiting sleep analyzer, which you put under the mattress, can actually collect very useful information. Let's go to this box. Sleep diary bedtime. We asked people to write down every evening, when do you go to sleep? This is the bedtime as assessed by this thing, which you simply put on your mattress, put in the mains, and you don't have to look after. And you can see that there's a pretty good correlation between these two measures. This is sleep diary. When did you get out of bed? This is the sleep diary. And again, you see a very good correlation. Here we have heart rate. Heart rate measured by an ECG or heart rate measured by this whipping sleep analyze. And again, you can see that the correlation is very good. So this technology now allows you to contactless obtain very important information about sleep and physiology. And that, of course, is going to enable us to do a lot of research. But this is now a recording from people living with dementia. And these data were analyzed by Al Sorek. And this is really work that was done within at Imperial in collaboration with us. So these are recordings in homes of people living with dementia, but these homes are equipped with many different sensors, including this under the mattress sensor. And what you can see here are data from May 2019 until, if I can see this, I can move it, January 2022. So you see long-term data. Blue means the person is in bed. And as you can see in this person number two, initially there is time in bed, but then all of a sudden the person starts spending more time in bed. And you can also see that now there are more interruptions and there are more daytime naps as well. So these kind of technologies allow you to longitudinally monitor changes and probably also predict changes in their cognitive status. So, of course, what you want to know, do these changes in sleep and do these day-to-day or night-to-night changes in sleep tell you anything about their waking behavior? Does it matter in dementia whether you have an interrupted night? Does it matter for your memory errors the next day? Or does it matter for your behavioral problems, like agitation? So what we did in the study with Sarah Bullock and others, you know, we asked people about their everyday memory errors, forgetting the name of friends, forgetting the names of common things, forgetting something you were told a few minutes ago. We also asked them about behavioral problems, appear sad or depressed, aggressive to others verbally. And we recorded sleep with one of these wearables. And then we looked at how aspects of sleep, in this particular case, sleep continuity, predicted daytime behavior. Now this means improvement, sleepiness. If your sleep continuity is better, you are less sleepy. Also, when you're a person living with dementia. If your sleep continuity is better, you will make fewer everyday memory errors. If your sleep continuity is better, your caregiver will report fewer behavioral problems. Now remember, this is not an experiment. We are not experimentally changing sleep continuity or sleep duration. This is just a spontaneous variation in sleep, which indeed associates and predicts the spontaneous variation in daytime functioning. So sleep indeed is for tomorrow. How you sleep tonight will predict how you are tomorrow. And when we talk about tomorrow, I think we should also talk about sleep and the planet of tomorrow and how these things may relate. What you see here in the left-hand corner is a very famous heat map made by Professor Hawkins, who's at the University of Reading. And from 1850 to 2017, he simply looked at average, I think these are global temperature, and they were color-coded according to temperature. Time goes in this direction, and it's pretty clear that the planet is getting hotter. That's a good way of illustrating this. What we see here is the M25 and light at night. So here we talk about temperature pollution, and here we talk about light pollution. And what does that have to do with sleep and sleep for tomorrow? Now, what we need to realize is that these geophysical cycles in light and temperature, this was the environment in which, you know, biological systems evolved, and there has been natural selection, and natural selection basically resulted in those environmental rhythms to be represented in our physiology. Actually, they are represented in our DNA and create internal rhythm. So what we know indeed is that we have an internal molecular genetic clock. It's synchronized to the environment by light. Here we have some of these molecular elements per and period and clock genes generate those rhythms. Now this molecular clock drives rhythms, and one of the rhythms it drives is the rhythm in core body temperature. Yeah, and that particular rhythm actually persists internal time, persists even if you are in a constant environmental condition. This internal clock also drives the rhythm in wakefulness and sleep. When temperature, your body temperature is high during the day, there's a strong drive for wakefulness. When body temperature is low, you can sleep well. Now, when we look at when we sleep relative to our environmental temperature cycle, and this is done here in by Yetis et al. In the Hadza, these are hunter-gatherers in Tanzania, and they have no access to artificial light. And this research group looked at when those people actually slept. Yeah? And first of all, they go to bed after sunset. They wake up before sunrise. We are running out of time. Otherwise, I would have asked you how many of you got up before sunrise this morning. But if you look at where sleep happens relative to the environmental temperature cycle, you see that indeed we sleep there when the environmental temperature is low. So our internal rhythm of body temperature is in parallel and in synchrony with these environmental cycles. And indeed, sleep regulation and temperature regulation are very closely related. So the question is, what is it like living in a place where it's 50 degrees Celsius? Well, the answer actually is, we have many sleepless nights. And this is just one story. And we talk about global changes in temperature, but actually when we look at where the largest changes are they during the day or during the night? Actually, the largest increases occur at night. And that's, of course, where we sleep. So as a sleep researcher, I would say, look, sleep is more affected by climate change than wakefulness. We should have a look at that. So that's just one thing. And fortunately, now there are more and more research groups who are really taking this very seriously, and I don't have time to go into this. But this is a study from a Danish research group. They looked at 7.41 million nighttime sleep recordings recorded by some of these wearables. They then link this with daily weather and other climate data. And they looked at the associations. They then found that higher nocturnal temperature does relate to less sleep. And then finally, they used climate models, which predicted how temperature would change over the next 10, 20, or 40 years. And you can then start predicting, you know, how much sleep you will lose depending on which kind of scenario you use for your relative concentration pathway for CO2. This study included 68 countries. This is a country study from the US, but the results are exactly the same. Now, interestingly, if you ask who is most affected, turns out that women are more affected by temperature change than men. It's very clear that older people are much more affected by this than young people. Temperature regulation is often impaired with aging. And of course, there are socioeconomic correlate with this as well. It's always true that the poor people are more affected than the wealthy people. There is no doubt about it. But we can stay closer at home. What you're looking at here are recordings of room indoor temperature in some of these people living with dementia at home. And these are data analyzed by Talia Rodriguez And you can, of course, look at outdoor temperature from May 21 until January 23. And obviously, it's warmer in spring and in summer than it is in winter, and the nights are longer in winter. But you can see that these outdoor temperatures are very well reflected in the indoor temperatures, including the bedroom. And we already know that indeed, also in these people, and that's work by Surrey, although we haven't published this yet, the magnitude of the sleep disturbances in these people living with dementia associate with these increases in temperature. So yes, we need to go to relatively simple approaches to improving sleep. And one simple approach would be to get better temperature control. Okay, I'm almost there. Why do we sleep so late? I talked about light pollution. Okay, light is a reason why we sleep so late. What you're looking at here is the light profile, the environmental light profile on the Hochberg for the locals. In late autumn, there isn't much light. Or in late spring, and of course, the days now are much longer, okay? You can also measure how much light people see by actually giving them one of these wearables. And you can see that in late autumn, we see a lot of light also after dusk because we turn on the artificial light. And even in late spring, we stay awake after dawn, after dusk. And it's this artificial light that makes it possible for us to sleep that late. Now we have to see whether this works. And I think it does.
But why do we procrastinate before going to sleep? Why do we struggle to get up in time for work or school? How did hunter-gatherers wake up at the crack of dawn without an alarm? It comes down to our internal biological clocks and light. With not enough at the right time and too much at the wrong time. Each day, as the Earth spins on its axis, the sun rises and sets, creating a regular pattern of dark and light. Creatures that best used this pattern gained an advantage and evolved internal biological clocks. But these clocks aren't perfect and either run too fast or too slow. These clocks run a little slow in most humans, but the natural day and night cycle adjusts our slow clocks to precisely 24 hours. But then came the invention of the electric light. With this new technology, humans were free from the tyranny of sunrise and sunset. Now people could work and play throughout the day and night without restriction. The natural day and night cycle no longer controlled us because now we could control light. Today, people spend many hours working in dimly lit factories, shops, and offices with little exposure to bright daylight. In the evening, people spend time in homes lit by electric light, often well after dusk. The problem is that we don't see enough light in the morning to speed up our slow clocks. And the extra light in the evening makes our clocks even slower. So when the wall clock says it's 11 p.m., our biological clocks may say it's only 10. We end up procrastinating and going to bed late, only to be woken by our alarm clocks. Because our biological clocks say it is too early and because we haven't slept enough, we struggle to get out of bed. By the weekend, people are exhausted and sleep in to catch up. So, what can we do? It turns out that light is both the problem and the solution. So, we should look for it during the day, but avoid it in the evening. Biologists have figured out the kind of light our biological clocks like the most. Mathematicians have figured out the equations that describe how much light we should seek and how much to avoid. Working together, we can use this knowledge to fix our biological clocks and tick towards a happier, healthier future.
Good. Okay. So we now know a lot about sleep and circadian rhythms. We have our models, and based on these models, we can really start engineering the bedroom of the future. We can put a lot of technology in these bedrooms. We can monitor our physiology, but maybe you think this is not how my bedroom of the future should look like. But this particular bedroom was designed not by a human being, but actually it was created by AI. And this, I think, is one of the wonderful things AI can do for you. You can ask it to design the bedroom of the future, and based on all its knowledge, it then basically creates this. But maybe it has some features of what we want, but I also think that it has many features that we don't want. Talking about the bedrooms of the future, I think we also don't want this to be the bedroom of the future. I spoke to you about the drive for sleep, and here you see a waste picker, you know, basically falling asleep, taking a nap. And many people, of course, in this world don't have a bedroom. And Malcolm Fonchamp, who was a professor here at Surrey, who was at this workshop, reminded us that when we talk about sleep, we often talk about sleep in our Western societies, and we don't talk about sleep in other countries and sleep of other people. People are maybe not as well off. Finally, of course, this Chat GPT. Many of us have heard about Chat GPT. It was fed millions and millions of books and a lot of information on the internet. So I asked it in preparation of this lecture, what is the future of sleep? The future of sleep is likely to involve advancements in sleep technology, agreed, greater emphasis on sleep health, agreed, and improved understanding of sleep's importance, agreed. We can expect the development of innovative sleep tracking devices, smart mattresses, and personalized sleep solutions, agreed. Sleep science and research will continue to uncover the intricacies of sleep and its impact on overall well-being, leading to more tailored approaches to sleep management. Again, agreed. With increasing awareness of the significance of quality sleep, individuals and society as a whole may prioritize sleep as a fundamental pillar of health and productivity. You see, ChatGPT is not too bad at all. You know, I couldn't have said it better myself. Sleep and the future, sleep and a sustainable future, of course, links into, you know, goal number 3 of the United Nations, you know, ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. And what we are trying to do at Surrey, and this is the photo we took during our celebration, is indeed do sleep research and do something useful with it. I thank you all for your attention.
Thank you, Dirk, and for a fantastic talk, really thought-provoking. I'm sure everybody's got lots of questions. Now there's an opportunity for us to take some questions about the lecture about sleep and the future of sleep.
What's the end of your talk? You talk about the different factors affecting sleep, light and temperature. You have to mention the effects of air conditioning.
No, absolutely. So air conditioning and air quality is a very important issue as well. And we have some data on outdoor sleep quality, outdoor air quality and sleep, but there isn't much yet. And there's very little data on indoor air quality and sleep. But obviously with these kind of technologies and these sensors, we can also measure indoor air quality and see how it relates to sleep. Yes.
Talking mostly about the research you're doing.
Oh, sorry. Hello. Can you hear me? All right. You were talking about the research using healthy people, participants, and then you talk about ageism. Now, one thing comes to mind is that as we get older, we're having to take medication on a regular basis. And some of that, I know from experience, disturbs the sleep. So is there any research on what sort of medications has a larger effect than others?
Yeah, so that's certainly a good point. And as you rightly mentioned, in that initial study, we used very healthy people. In the later study, when we were testing the technology to be used for dementia, we actually took pretty much a general sample with people who actually did take medications and had health problems, older people. And indeed, you can then start looking at how different medications affect sleep. Now, I myself haven't done much work on that, but there is certainly a lot of work being done in that area, and how antihypertensives, antidepressants, antipsychotics, etc., affect sleep. Actually, in that cohort of people living with dementia, obviously get a lot of medication as well and have various health conditions. And a PhD student of Dave Sharp, who's leading that effort, made a wonderful analysis with that under the mattress sleep analyzer, how changes in medication actually led to changes in those sleep patterns. And that's something that is of great interest and relevance.
Question at the back.
I've read some articles suggesting that the quality of sleep is important in CSF circulation and the effect it might have on molecules such as amyloid molecules. Can you comment on that?
Yeah, no. This is a hypothesis put forward by Martin Navegaard now quite a few years ago. And the basic hypothesis is that there are all kinds of waste products building up during wakefulness. They need to be cleared from the brain, and this could maybe best happen during sleep, and that clearance would take place via what is referred to as the glymphatic system, which is basically the lymph system for the brain. And in essence, it states that the space between cells in the brain and between neurons increase during sleep, and that would make it easier to flush out these waste products, such as amyloid. That's a very interesting hypothesis. Many, many people are looking into this hypothesis. I think the hypothesis has not yet been rejected, so we continue to hope that's indeed the case.
In the sentence.
I can do it without it.
Okay.
Mr. Dijk, awesome lecture. My question, what is being done to bring these kind of findings and recommendations to operationalize them in national government, international context, in the UK, abroad?
Yeah, so dissemination of this type of information, the first step is writing an article for a scientific journal, go to a congress. Another step is organize public lectures. Other steps are trying to get the message out to politicians. It is true that the House of Lords Science Committee recently actually had a hearing about the impact of light pollution on health, and we submitted evidence for that particular hearing. I mean, I've been doing this type of research since 1983, and I can tell you that the knowledge about sleep and circadian rhythms in the general public has increased dramatically, and also for politicians.
one of the things I tell my colleagues is, look, if you want people to take sleep seriously, or you want people to take light seriously or temperature seriously, you should look at climate change or COVID, because what have we seen there? People have developed models to predict the rate of climate change, to predict the consequences of climate change. Or for COVID, we have models that predict the effects of certain interventions. We need to convince politicians that we understand sleep and circadian rhythm so well that we can come up with quantitative predictive models so that we can tell them, if you do this, you will increase productivity by this much, or you will reduce sleep-related driving deaths by this kind of number. So I think that's the way we need to do it.
What's your view on the effectiveness of sleep aids like Nitol? Can you actually get quality sleep, or is it not very good quality sleep?
Yeah, so Nitol's main ingredient is an antihistamine. Histamine neurons very much help you to stay awake during the day. And by blocking the receptors for histamine, you become sleepy. Unfortunately, the antihistamines are not considered a real sleep drug because they cause hangover effects, headaches in particular. To me, it's surprising that it's over-the-counter available. But then I suspect that the serious side effects of Nitol and other antihistamines are not that prevalent or are indeed relatively rare. Now, my general view about sleep aids or sleeping pills is that I think they can be very useful, certainly in acute cases of insomnia. Somebody has severe sleep problems because something seriously happened in the family, or severe stress. Obviously, it's not necessarily a good thing when they are being used chronically.
You talk about sleep aids, wearables, and obviously the benefit in information gathering. I just wanted to know how you think that might be navigated in terms of creating anxiety around sleep, you know, targets for sleep. What is about not getting enough sleep, or maybe not perceiving sleep as something that you do, but as a device tells you?
Yeah, no, I think that's a very relevant question. Some people have introduced the concept of the quantified self. We want to measure everything, but then we can also become anxious about it because we become obsessed about it. Oh, I didn't sleep 7 hours. What's going to happen next? What I say about sleep and sleep duration, and I haven't said this in this lecture, but I will say it now. Sleep should be taken seriously, but not too seriously. And I think that's an important message. You know, one night of poor sleep, you know, isn't going to make you demented. Yeah. And so one night that your wearable tells you that you didn't get much deep sleep is not a problem. Simon Kyle, who is in Oxford, he did a very interesting experiment. He gave wearables, some kind of a gadget, to people. I think they were actually people suffering from insomnia. And that gadget gave them feedback in the morning. Okay, your sleep was bad or good or whatever. Now, that feedback was randomly generated. Yeah. Well, it had nothing to do with their sleep. Okay. And then he looked at how people felt during the rest of the day. Yeah. And the people who were told that they had had a poor night's sleep said that the rest of the day was miserable too, just because the device told them their sleep wasn't good. And I get these kind of phenomena is what you are rightly referring to. And we need to be careful on how we communicate. We shouldn't panic. We shouldn't be, you know, obsessed about sleep or whatever. We should be reasonable.
Question in the center.
Can you see the work that you're doing leading to the development of an optimized mattress or sleep machine of the future?
Yeah, so sleep machines of the future, I mean, maybe there are already companies that believe that they have made certain machines or gadgets that can help you sleep, different ways to deliver noise or whatever. But sleep enhancement is, I think, serious business. Of course, there has already been, and there already is, pharmacological modulation of sleep. Yeah, and there are certain compounds that can enhance deep sleep, for example. Whether that's really deep sleep is another question. So you can do it with pharmacology. There are other approaches which are referred to as neuromodulation. So what you can do is you can deliver auditory stimuli to the brain in synchrony with the ongoing brain oscillations. And you can then enhance those oscillations. And several research groups have shown that you can, to some extent, influence, for example, that deep sleep. We, together with Ines Bialand, whom I mentioned, being from Portugal and is in psychology, together with a postdoc, Valeria Jaramillo, are actually working in that area and trying to enhance rapid eye movement sleep, which I said was much more important than slow wave sleep, although that may be a slight overstatement, but at least we are working on these kind of things. So, you know, where we're going to end up is unclear. But yes, I think it'd be great if we could improve sleep.
So you're implying that for everybody, there is a standard 7 hours sleep per night.
No, I didn't say that at all. I didn't say that at all. I'm not going to ask you how much sleep you get, but
there's time for two very quick questions.
I was just wondering how much you could use the data from apps, for example, the sleep cycle or whatever, nearables, wearables that are already out there. It's probably on the metadata side of things because it wouldn't be the controlled environment, but they do look at temperature and your heart rate and your REM cycle, apparently. I don't know how they measure it and that sort of thing. So how much use can you make of that data that's already there without having to take a...
So in terms of the reliability of these data, and we looked into that in quite a bit of detail for that technology evaluation. Some measures coming out of these wearables are quite good, like heart rate. They're also quite good at measuring activity. In terms of measuring sleep structure, how much deep sleep or how much REM sleep you get, I don't think that they are very good at all at the moment. Now, of course, if you're doing truly data science, and you're looking at, you know, a couple of million 24-hour periods, even though the quality of the data may not be fantastic, there may still be useful and reliable information because of the enormous size of the data. And that's one way data science works. And you've seen those data, you know, from the One Health journal, where people looked at wearable data from 68 countries, where you saw our own data, where a nearable can very accurately assess a heart rate. So I think there is useful information, but we like to know how reliable it is. And that's why we're doing these evaluations.
Final question.
You were talking about people with sleep that was disturbed at the ages of about 50 to 70, I think, in one of the slides, that causing a higher incidence of dementia, if I can speak correctly. Have you looked at the other side of that, looking at people with dementia, and perhaps what their working patterns were, shift workers, pilots, people who work overnight and such like, and whether then you start seeing higher incidence of dementia, unfortunately, in some of those people who've had through necessity to be employed in those sort of nighttime activities.
Yeah. So the Whitehall study was really about sleep duration, as you rightly mentioned. These were people in their 50s. There are studies on shift work
and cognitive decline and shift work and dementia. There definitely is a risk of cognitive decline associated with shift work, even in this, and that's work. There is a UK group, and the Karolinska Institute has worked a lot on that. So shift work is not healthy for sure. The good thing about shift work is that you can do studies where you can see that if, for example, well, 20 years of night work is bad, yeah? But if you now stop doing night shifts and you look 10 years later, you see actually a recovery. So there is a reduction of that risk with recovery. To some extent, it is reversible. But don't misunderstand me. Shift work is not healthy. That's one thing for sure.
Okay, so we've come to the end of the event, and I'd just like to take this opportunity to thank you all for coming this evening. But of course, thank Dirk Jan for a fantastic talk and lecture. We've all learned, I'm sure, a lot about sleep, and we all need to rush off now and get plenty of sleep. Please join me in thanking Dirk Jan.